Planning Commission meeting to order. I see that on Zoom we have Wilson Feesey and Nelson DeLeon here in the room. We have Peter Rye, Bob Conklin, and myself. I'm Wayne Buehler. I am the chairman. Next on our agenda, we welcome our new city planner who joins us for the first time this month. And so I'll turn it over to Brandy Davis to introduce herself.
Thank you very much.
Sorry about that, everyone. Thank you for the welcome. My name is Brandy Davis. I started at the beginning of the month. I just recently graduated from the University of Oregon, Master of Community and Regional Planning Program, and I was working at the university in the General Counsel's office, the legal assistant admin coordinator. So I'm very excited to join the city, and I look forward to working with the commission and the community.
Go Ducks.
Okay. Next, we will. Do I hear a motion to accept the Planning Commission meeting agenda for September 27th as sent out this afternoon, as amended this afternoon?
So move.
Okay. Thank you, Nelson. Second by Peter. And all those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, very good. Okay, first plan to be reviewed for today is 1849 Perkiomen Avenue subdivision plan. This is a preliminary final plan, and I'll turn it over to Jerome for the update.
Okay, this plan was brought in as a revised preliminary/final subdivision plan. We did a review on September 21st, 2021. This is a two-lot subdivision, both commercial lots, lot one being 3,174 square feet, and which will be contained as a commercial building or for retail use, or a convenience store. Lot two is a 12,739 square foot building, which has two buildings which accommodate 18 garages. We had several lengthy discussions in the past with regards to the stormwater management as well as site accessibility issues. Those have all been cleaned up to the satisfaction of Public Works as well as the solicitor. The remaining items that are on here are just typical items that are required prior to the plan being endorsed by the Planning Commission and released for recording. So if you do wish to approve the plan, it would be subject to the remaining conditions in the September 21st, 2022 review.
Very good. Do you have anything, Mr. Fox?
Just to refresh my memory, there's no proposed new buildings or additions or anything like that. We're just doing a subdivision. Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the commissioners? Okay, hearing none. Mr. Fonts, do you have anything?
One thing we got bumped for September. Wait, we're in September. August, I'm sorry. Days go by. It was all about the access, the preliminary access or whatever it was called there, in front of the garages that had to be documented by the city's attorney.
Yeah.
I think that's all we were waiting for.
Yep. And that's taken care of.
Right. That's what Rob told me, that everything was taken care of. Yeah. Other than that, I mean, I don't know anything else that's
good.
I only have one question. The square footage on the building, the front building, can you tell me that again? Because I don't know that.
On the plan, it references 3,174 square feet.
All right, thank you. Oh, it's right there.
Mr. Chairman, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead, Will.
Thank you. I think the Zoom had to be muted earlier. So I see there are easements, which is prudent. So did we ever resolve the status of the I don't know what to call it, the road or what had been the trolley route in terms of vacation of the stream. And if we did not, I guess the easement would probably be sufficient.
Yes, well, it was. We have an easement that has been prepared. It is a branch off of from 19th Street, providing access to the garage spaces.
Right, but also, I mean, did we ever determine if that had ever been vacated?
19th Street?
Yeah.
The little leftover.
The little leftover.
Right. That one piece towards the southwest.
Which is now the easement.
Which area was owned by the city.
Okay.
I can't hear, sorry.
We determined it was owned by the city, therefore necessitating the easement.
That makes sense now. That's why I was thinking that in order for us to have the right to execute an easement, we would have to establish the ownership. And we're leaving it as such, with the easement being sufficient then.
Yes.
So that makes sense. So we don't have to worry about asking council for a vacation. We could cover it with this. And that's good. And I think that resolves every legal question we had. Thank you.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, Will. Okay, with that, I just want to thank Mr. Ponce for his patience with this process. This has taken a long time. We really appreciate it. Do I hear a motion to grant conditional final approval for the 1849 Perkiom and Avenue subdivision plan, subject to the applicant resolving all issues referenced within the review letter by Hawk Valley Associates, dated September 21st, 2022.
I'll move such a motion, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you, Will. Second?
Second.
Okay, thank you, Bob. Okay, all those in favor, question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Very good. Thank you very much. Best of luck to you, Mr. Ponce, in your continued endeavors. And as you know, everything moves slow in the city, but they are looking at that building across the street from your parking lot on Reed Street.
Did you see what they did to that building catty corner from me?
Oh. I was really surprised when I was down there the other day.
They did a nice job with that
pictures, and because you were very concerned about that building too.
Yeah, it was ready to fall over too.
And somebody came in and fixed up the entire building. Really beautiful job. Did new stone work on the building and everything.
Yeah, really nice. They're not done with it yet, but it still looks nice.
Yeah. So with Mr. Ponce's help with the doing all the work on that parking lot, I think that kind of kicked things off in that intersection.
I hope so.
So
I was promised new streetlights up there, but I don't hold my breath on stuff like that.
The next new set of streetlights are actually going to come in. Well, I have a new streetlight at my house, but the next new set of streetlights is going to be Spring Street from Center Avenue to 13th.
Yeah, the city council person told me that they would advocate to put the street lights in and make some of those people fix some of them sidewalks, you know.
Yeah. So we'll I'll make a note of that and make sure to follow up on it as best as I can.
Yeah, I know the routine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. Next we go to 531 Upland Avenue. Annexation and land development plan for 527, 529, and 531 Upland Avenue. And I'll turn it over to Jerome for the update.
Okay. This project is identified as 531 Upland Avenue. My office has reviewed this on September 21st, 2022. This is a preliminary land development plan application. The project involves a parcel of land that has been consolidated with 12,319 square feet. It will be utilized for a proposed six unit, residential apartment unit. The existing building will be raised and there will be stormwater management facilities, and there'll be 9 parking spaces in the rear with rear access to an alley. All those issues have been taken care of. We've had conducted a site review with Public Works to verify accessibility issues, as well as improvements that are going to be necessary. The applicant has agreed to move the parking lot into the site about another 5 feet, which would provide better movement for ingress and egress out of the facility. We had further discussions with sanitary sewage disposal and stormwater management. There are still some items that will need to be addressed, and that could be accomplished as part of the final plan for this project. The applicant is requesting 2 waivers requests, one being under section 515.304 of the Subdivision and Land Development Ordinance, which is in regards to the applicant's part of the way.
Actually, Jerome, may I interrupt here?
Hey, yeah.
We actually withdrew the waiver request for the preliminary final. So the only waiver request we're really asking for is the plan scale.
Yeah, okay. Which is prepared at 1 inch to 10 feet, which provides more detail. Okay. Great. So that should conclude all our comments. They will be back with the final plan application. The plan also has been reviewed in addition by Public Works, as well as the city arborist. And we've all provided comments.
Yeah, I see that Lester was very busy this week.
Yeah.
Okay, does anyone from the Planning Commission have any questions or comments on this plan? Yes. Let's see here. And I forgot your name, sir, the representative for this project.
Craig Bonnenberger.
Craig, there we go. Craig, do you have any questions for the commissioners or the staff?
I don't believe so. I think everything is pretty straightforward. We got comments from the arborist, and we will be taking those comments and incorporating them into our final plan. And I think pretty much everything else is a final plan issue. A lot of certifications and that sort of thing. So yeah, I don't have any questions for the Planning Commission.
Thank you. All right, and then first thing we'll do then is go to get. Do I hear a motion to allow a waiver of section 515-402.A.2 of the Subdivision and Land Development Ordinance that will permit the scale of the plan to be one inch equals 10 feet?
Bob Hoplin will make that motion.
Very good. Thank you, Bob. Second?
Sure.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Okay, question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, we have a waiver. And very good. And since nobody has any questions, we're ready to get preliminary plan approval, right? Yeah. Okay, do I hear a motion to grant conditional preliminary plan approval for 531 Upland Avenue Annexation Land Development Plan, subject to the applicant resolving all issues referenced within the review letter by Hawk Valley Associates, dated September 21st, 2022.
So move.
Okay, thank you, Nelson. Better find out where I am here. There we go. Okay, second.
Second.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Okay, question on the motion?
Mr. Chair, I just wanted to say, really appreciate that the applicant has modified this plan substantially, especially in regard to the access to the alley, which I think is really convenient for the residents. I think this sort of thing it's better for safety, and of course I think it helps reduce some of the traffic and double parking issues we have, the more we can use the alleys in the city. So I just wanted to note that. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Very good. Okay, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, very good. We have a preliminary plan approval, and we hope to see you very soon, Craig, with the final.
I think we'll be in with it for next month, so we look forward to being there with you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next. We have the 1010-1012 Lancaster Avenue Annexation Plan. This is the first time coming before before us, so I will turn it over to Jerome to explain what's going on.
Hey, this plan was reviewed by my office on September 22nd, 2022. It is an annexation plan. There was previous zoning relief that was granted to the applicant with regards to this project, in which part of the order was to consolidate the parcels of land. There uses that are permitted the site is located within the CH or the Commercial Highway Zoning District, which does permit these uses. It was a bit complicated in determining what was going on with the project, so I inquired with the zoning office to weigh in on what is being actually proposed. I think it was ultimately determined that there is going to be 6 apartment units. There are 9 or 10 parking spaces in the rear of the property, so it does have the parking spaces that are available for the site. It does have sanitary sewage connection, water supply. Some things that we weren't clear about was if there was going to be a remaining commercial use on the property. Things that we should probably note on this plan, just for clarification. We also typically like to have the decision being referenced from the zoning hearing board with the date it was issued, the zoning hearing board appeal number, and the order. So that's something we want to add. I think Tom is our zoning officer, or zoning administrator, is on the line. And Tom, do you have anything further?
No, I don't have anything further. I mean, if you want that information, I can give it to you now, or I can just send it to you.
Your report.
Just the zoning hearing board decision, you know, for the date and the directions.
Yeah. I have that. And
okay.
That's one of the comments we had. I think the applicant is also on the line.
Yes, sir, I am.
Is that you, Brad?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Hey, Brad, how you doing?
I'm doing well. Yourself?
Pretty good. Do you have any further comments on this project?
No. Tell me what you need on the plan, and we'll put it on, and hopefully we're good to go.
Just for clarification, Jerome, are you asking for the plan to show the weak commercial uses, for the permit to show what the uses will be?
We wanted to have what the current uses are on the property, and or what they will be. The property is going through some renovations, it's our understanding. And the zoning office is coordinating those. So whatever's on their current zoning permits now, I want it reflected on the plan.
And do you want the proposed use as well, or just the current?
If we know it, yes, as long as it's consistent with the zoning hearing board's decision. And I think they've committed to having 6 apartment units. Is that correct, Brad?
Honestly, I don't know. I prepared this plan in conformance with the zoning hearing board decision and in compliance. The zoning hearing decision stated that we should put together a plan. Obviously, our owner owns both parcels right now. The zoning hearing board decided that it should be combined in parcels, and I leave all of the other zoning issues up to resolution between the owner and the zoning board.
If your client is unable to commit to a land use, then we could just put a note on the plan that it would be a zoning and building permit would be required for the use that's going to be proposed on the site.
I have no problem with that. This plan just represents one of the pieces of the puzzle that the zoning hearing board required of us to do.
This is Emily with the zoning office. The zoning permit application was for 6 residential units and 1 commercial unit.
Okay. Yeah, so that's all we're going to need on the plan then, Brad. Yep. We could forward you the zoning permit itself. So you could be.
Yeah, I have all of that, Jerome. I'm more than happy to add all of that.
Okay. Then that's what we need. That's what we need to add. So if the applicant is willing to comply with that, we're ready for municipal approval, subject to the comments in this letter.
Yes, we will comply.
Hello, my name is Sanjay Kapoor. I'm the owner of the property 10-10-10-12. If I may speak further, please.
Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Everybody's time is very important, and I really appreciate that everybody's giving us opportunity to talk and trying to approve this. I do have everything going through the city in a proper way as we need it. It is like ma'am said it, it's a six apartments and a commercial, and we do have 12 parkings in the back as well.
And I was wrong in the review. Within the CH zoning district, you are allowed to have 2 principal uses on the property.
Okay, that was the question that I had.
So Tom had clarified that for me.
Great. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any questions or comments from the commissioners?
Mr. Chairman, this is Bob Conklin. I don't know if you noticed on the attachments to the zoning application, but it was my logo that was on there. This is a past client of mine. Our contract has been filled with them, so we don't have any more relationship with them at this time. I don't know if I need to recuse myself or not, or if there's a recommendation to have myself recuse. I was not the principal in charge of this project either.
We have 4 members, correct? 4 members, we have 5 present, correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
Just out of caution, I don't think you have a conflict.
Okay.
But I think out of caution, I would ask you to recuse yourself.
Thank you.
Great. Okay. Anything else from the commissioners?
Yes, I have a question, Mr. Chairman. Okay, I read the zoning hearing board's decision that in 2016, there was relief granted as far as the consolidation of the 2 parcels. Which were 2 halves of a semi-detached house, which I presume were each 1 family unit. So I know, of course, this was several zoning administrators ago. Was there relief also from the moratorium on increasing single unit dwellings to multi-unit apartments? Because that was going from what would be 2 to 6. Was that part of the relief or what?
So this is only the zoning office. That stipulation doesn't apply in the CH district. The prohibition of converting a single family home to multifamily, that's mostly in the residential zoning districts that prohibits that.
Yeah, I think we have that in the R3 district.
Okay, then that explains it.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what the prior use was then in that zoning district. Okay, well, we learned something there. Thank you.
Very good. Anything else from anyone? Okay. Hearing that, Jerome, you said it's okay to go.
Yeah.
Go ahead with the.
I thought it was a lot more complicated than it's rather easy.
Yeah, it does seem rather easy.
Okay, with that, do I hear a motion to grant conditional preliminary final planner application approval for 1010 1012 Lancaster Avenue, subject to the applicant resolving all issues referenced within the review letter by Hawk Valley Associates dated September 22nd, 2022. Peter?
Yep.
Okay. Second?
I'll second.
Okay. Thank you, Will. Question on the motion?
Just take note that I'm going to be sustaining my vote.
Okay. And with that, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. And then one abstention just out of the abundance of caution. So thank you very much. Good luck on this project to you. I see in the pictures that the renovations are coming along. So good luck, and we wish you the best.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you. Okay, next we have Holy Trinity Church of God Land Development Plan. This is a final plan review for 1541 Montgomery Street. I'll hand it over to Jerome for the update.
Okay, this is the Holy Trinity Church of God Land Development Plan. Our review is dated September 23rd, 2022. This is a final plan application. This involves 6.40 acre tract of land that has an existing one family dwelling on it that will be converted to part of the proposed use, which is going to be a worship center with an administrative building as well as a residential use on the property. Zoning Hearing Board has granted relief on this project. We did review this as a preliminary plan application. This is now a final plan application. We had asked the applicant in previous to just evaluate the steep slope overlay district. I have asked the zoning administrator just to verify those requirements for the record. That could be accomplished before we consider municipal approval. Parts of the site is also located in the floodplain overlay district. There are no improvements that are going to impact that, but as per our provisions in the zoning ordinance, it will require a zoning permit from the zoning administrator. So just want to make sure that we're all on board with that. Finally, we're also located within the airport overlay district. So we wanted to make sure that there was no conflicts there. So those three items we are still in a need to check and see what's necessary there. We've also provided some comments with site accessibility within the site, which they're just now down to a few points. And the plan was also submitted to the Fire and Rescue Department for review, as well as Building and Trade. So they have comments also. We've also submitted to the certified arborist for the City of Reading for their review, and I believe that they have approved this plan. And finally, we've had issued several stormwater management requirement issues that will need to be resolved. Probably the biggest comments that we have left are the street vacations that are identified on the plan. We just want to make sure we have everything all lined up before we have the plan ready for approval. Tim is not here. He's out sick for this meeting, but he did provide comments that he did agree with what we had in place. We did submit this plan also, or sent it to Burr Township for their review, since sanitary sewer extension goes over to their area, as well as the street vacation would apply to them as well. and they're a neighboring property. So all that being said, I would recommend that we table this plan until we get more information, and I think we might be in a better position next. Very good. Any questions or comments from the commissioners?
We were also talking about changing the street address.
Yeah. The street address would also need to be brought to first Public Works. Public Works then assesses what the number would be most likely, and we suggested a Lackawanna Street address versus a utilizing the data we have now for Montgomery. Yeah. It makes sense because Montgomery is being vacated. So that then after Public Works has the number assigned, it then goes to Berks County 911. Is there anyone here? Yeah, very good. Just a comment that because of the reasons that Jerome mentioned about Burn Township having a sewer line, I'm not sure who owns the sewer line, but it goes through Burn Township. And the street vacation has a little bit to do with Burn Township as part of the municipal planning code. We needed to send that over to Burn Township for for review. So we actually can't act until it comes back from there to make sure they have no objections. Any other comments from the commissioners? Okay, just still checking, no one here for this plan. Yeah, I don't see anyone either. Although I have my glasses on. So. Very good. With that, do I hear a motion to table the Holy Trinity Church of God land development plan?
So move.
Okay, Nelson and
Peter.
Nelson, Peter with the second. Question on the motion? All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, very good. Very good. Well, we'll see this come back next month, and hopefully Greg will have everything squared away with this. So next we have 743 Thorn Street parking lot land development plan, preliminary plan application review for two lots. And I will turn it over to Jerome, since this is the first time that this is coming before us.
Yeah. This plan is was reviewed by our office as an annexation as well as a land development plan, more so as an annexation plan for now. The plan was reviewed on September 24, 2022. This is the two principal addresses are 730 North 3rd Street, which is an 11,628 square foot lot, which contains an existing residential use. It's a one family semi-detached dwelling, or one half of the dwelling, or one half of the semi-detached dwelling. And then parcel B is a 2,800 plus or minus square foot, which is 743 Thorn Street. The applicant is proposing to combine these two parcels of land and then also utilize the part that fronts Thorn Street as a parking lot, which would contain 16 off-street parking spaces. There, this is where the land development component comes in. It was unclear at first what the uses were going to be because of combining. This is in the R3 zoning district, and if you had a freestanding parking facility in the R3 zoning district, it would not be in compliance unless it was part of another use that would require that parking area. So
we investigate this a lot further, and we talked to the zoning administrator, and it's our understanding now that the parking lot would be utilized for a restaurant that's located along Douglas Street, which does touch the parking area, so it would be semi-contiguous. The configuration of the lots as proposed does not make sense because they have the residential property that's located also in the historic district, that would be part of the parking area. Parking area should be part of the restaurant use or commercial use that would apply to Douglas Street. So that's some of the information we've uncovered over the last couple of days. And we do have a number of other issues, but that's primarily the issues. We've provided also several issues with regarding site accessibility, as well as stormwater management. But I'd like to turn it over to Tom, our zoning administrator, to see if he has anything to add to this, since a lot of this was uncovered by him.
I don't really have a whole lot to add, but there's a number of problems that this application would have because it is the R3. So the restaurant use is a non-conforming use. And so if they're looking to add parking, they're in a sense making it more intensive because they would be trying to get more people to come, that kind of thing. If it's a principal parking lot, that's a problem because the R3 residential zones don't allow more than one principal use per lot. And currently the lot has the semi-detached home. So they would need zoning relief for that. If it is going to be used for the restaurant, they would need zoning relief for that, for the expansion of a non-conforming use. Because the expansion of a non-conforming use doesn't just only look at the square footage of the restaurant. It looks at the land associated with that use. So if this parking would be part of that, that they would need zoning relief for that. So one way or another, they're going to need to go to the zoning hearing board. And I've been working on a letter. I circulated it among staff at this point just to kind of produce some discussion, and I can finalize that and send that out. But we wanted to meet tonight to see what the applicant had to say and what the intentions were.
Just for the purpose of identifying where this restaurant use is, it's located on the north side of the property. If you're looking at your screen, it's probably where the word proposed is.
Corner of
Thorne and Douglas,
which was
of Pito Scatcher Club.
Yeah. And what was it before that? I've lived in the neighborhood so long, you would think I would remember what it was before that. So it is a restaurant that probably would benefit from a parking lot. As Tom had mentioned, some form of zoning relief is going to be required. And then possibly looking at the separation of the parking lot from the residential use should be looked at further. It could easily be divided so that the residential use doesn't have the parking lot on it. Is Amy on board? Amy Johnson? Okay, we've also provided her with copies of the plan just for comment. And we would also want to make sure that, since part of this project is located within the historic district, we want to make sure that they weigh in with their comments as well.
Yeah, I mentioned to Jerome that this might need a certificate of appropriateness.
So if Amy had provided comments in response to your email earlier today, she had mentioned that they would need, specifically for like the landscaping or lighting or things like that, would need HARP approval if they don't separate it from the Third Street from the house, because that's the lot that's in the historic district is the North Third Street address. Thorne Street parcel is not located in the historic district.
Dan, are you on the line?
Yeah, I'm here, and I've just been enlightened with something, because I was in the understanding that the Third Street property was where the restaurant is, and now you're informing that it's on the Douglas Street. So my what I was proposing there isn't quite right.
That's it. Yeah, we're gonna have to make some adjustments to the plan.
Yeah,
and yeah. As Tom had mentioned, more than likely you're going to be have to go back for further zoning relief.
Yeah, well, if we have a good, concise letter from Tom, then we can probably address those issues at a zoning hearing. I think what I have there is a decent type parking lot laid out for that area. We can probably move it around a little bit, since the parking is supposed to be closer to the Douglas Street side rather than the way I was laying that out, so I could get my handicapped accessibility and stuff up to a building that isn't the restaurant. So, yeah. So we can adjust things a little bit, and I'll have to adjust the lighting.
Okay. So, I would recommend we just table this.
Because there's a number of things we need to take a look at, but I'm glad you're handling it, Dan, because you're very familiar with everyone here.
Yeah. So probably what if that's the case, then what we would want to do is subdivide a portion of that the Third Street property off and annex it to the Thorn Street property, and then the Thorn Street property would be annexed to the Douglas Street property. Is that what we're looking at?
More than likely.
Yeah, because I noticed when I did the adjoiners that they own a piece of property up on Douglas Street, but I didn't have a clue what it was.
Yep, there it is.
Okay.
Very good. We're gonna have to keep an eye on this. More than likely your zoning hearing board, by the time that's scheduled, we'll probably run out of time for this. So but maybe next month we'll consider a time extension for this project.
Okay. Okay.
So we'll work on that for next month, though.
Okay.
Any questions? Yes. Will, go ahead.
Yeah. This is your neighborhood. Was this the former Tommy's restaurant, and then it was a Latino restaurant?
Yeah. Tommy's.
Okay,
yeah.
That's what I was talking about.
But the
now that we're talking about, now that I understand where the restaurant and what this is for too, okay, that's what I didn't have time to look into. Okay, yeah, I was in there. It's a nice facility. There aren't really any other sit down. I thought it had closed, so I'm hoping there's something coming in its place.
Yeah,
the neighborhood doesn't have anything else, other than bed and breakfast and places where you can have catering and that.
Yeah.
Fine facilities, but you don't have anything else. Nature, so that's great. Okay.
Sofrito.
Yeah, Sofrito.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Sofrito. Yeah. Yeah. It was nice place there. So.
Yeah, that was it. Think of the name. Thank you.
Yeah. What I understand.
It was nice.
Had to close down because they didn't pay their renewal on their liquor license. Which is like $5,000 or something. I forget what it is off the top of my head. I should know, but. Yeah, they're not cheap. so it might be changing ownership. So we'll see. I will say that, yes, going there, it is difficult finding parking. So if we can get the zoning issues squared away, it should work out very well and make sure that we get the hard issue squared away, because the hard, I understand, it's not too pleased that they cleared all the trees off of the Third Street site. So very good. Any other comments? Okay, with that, do I hear a motion to table 743 Thorn Street parking lot land development plan?
I'll offer that motion.
Okay, thank you, Will. Second?
Second.
Okay, thank you, Nelson. Question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Okay, very good. We will table this and send it over to the zoning hearing board and have Tom do his magic. Next on the list, we have 641 McKnight Street parking lot land development plan. I gotta find it. I don't have the what's called. So, that's it. Yeah. Okay. Just had to refresh my memory. And with this, I'll turn it over to Jerome for the update.
Okay, this is the 641 McKnight Street parking facility land development plan. It was submitted as a preliminary slash final plan. Its review date is September 24th, 2022. This is a 30,960 square foot parcel of land located at 641 McKnight Street. It is proposed as a parking facility, which is to include 82 off-street parking spaces. The area was previously utilized, abandoned, and demolition efforts have occurred, so it's a vacant. It's currently a vacant property. It is located within the R3 zoning district. A surface parking area is permitted within the zoning district, subject to requirements. The zoning administrator is aware of this project as well and is evaluating this as this property. There are a number of issues that we have brought up regarding site accessibility and vehicular access, which we have provided to the applicant. Some are easy to address, some of them are a little more complicated. We've also had asked the fire rescue department to review site accessibility issues. There will be some curbs and sidewalks that will need to be evaluated along McKnight Street by Public Works. They appear to be in fair condition, but we want to make sure that they had reviewed them as well. There was no stormwater management plan or report that was submitted with this application. We should be getting that real soon. So that part was missing from this portion of the project. Erosion and sedimentation control is also going to be required. We've also submitted the plans to the city arborist, who has provided comments on this plan, and there are a few other issues that need to be resolved. We feel that the applicant, once they submit these stormwater management requirements and address any potential zoning conflicts on this plan from the zoning administrator, we would probably like to see this plan tabled until those issues are resolved. Tom, do you have anything immediately you want to add?
No, I mean, the only two things I had on my letter were the number of trees and then the 100% impervious. So my guess is something will work out with the trees, you know, with the arborist, and then, but they'll have to probably most likely get zoning relief for the impervious coverage.
Well, I think this, well, I'm sure this property was originally completely covered by building. So the impervious cover is really an existing non-conformity up until, I mean, even now it's a hard packed gravel and it's used for parking. So I don't know, I don't really know why we would need to go for zoning relief for the 100% cover since it's already it's an existing condition.
Yeah, that'll be a call for Tim Crawl, but basically from the street view from 2019 and perhaps even before, the amount of greenery and grass that's growing there, there's a certain statute of limitations of how far you can go back and claim previous impervious coverage, you know, from a building. So if Tim Crawl signs off on it regarding the like the stormwater management plan and the, you know, the stormwater ordinance, and right, he's okay with it, then yeah, we could probably bypass the zoning hearing board. But my understanding is that there's a limit to how far back you can go.
I think that this is your call, not Tim's. You are the zoning administrator, so I think if you've determined that it's been more than 2 years.
That building burned down when my son was six. My son is now 22.
Yeah, the guidelines for nonconformity would have gone. Mm-hmm. It is what it is now, and therefore,
and that packed gravel is actually the brick left over from the demolition of that building, because that was an emergency demolition because that building burned down.
Yeah, also, I remember that, Mr. Was it old red brick factory building?
That's correct. That's correct, Will. Also, remember
but
that.
I don't remember how many years, but what you say, that timeline sounds about right.
Also, remember that the property across the street is now storage and parking, and they went through full land development and did the whole deal. They have planters, they have everything.
I was going to say, Mr. Chairman, we had approved that across the street. And if you recall, there was some issue there because of the slope. But I think where this parcel is, it's more flat. Is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. This is fairly flat parcel.
Yeah, there's a retaining
we don't have
wall.
That concern here. Okay, yeah, good.
There's a retaining wall that makes it flat. So
that's correct.
On the left side of the diagram, it's level with street. And then on the right-hand side of the diagram, it becomes several feet. And then it's a graduated retaining wall as you go from left to right and increases. So it kind of takes a slope and just kind of brings it up and makes it flat.
And it is a challenging property to have it landscaped and buffered.
Yeah. Yeah. But like I said, if you take a look at the property across the street, the retaining walls, the planters, and everything that they did across the street, that's what we required for that building across the street. Building across the street was also a factory that burned down a few years before this one that we're talking about now. So they're almost the same.
I do support Tom's opinion on this.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's just a little bit of background. Because I used to have I used to work with Folk Lutheran Church around the corner, and I remember that building burning down because I was there. I was working there at the time.
It was on the southwest corner there, that little square.
As far as tabling the plan, I know that the Reading Parking Authority. I'm sorry, is somebody else talking?
Yeah.
I apologize.
Yeah, we're just something on the plan.
What's located in the fenced in area, located on the southwest corner of the property?
That's a UGI pumping station.
It's a UGI gas facility there.
That means they're going to have all the easements and stuff for that.
Well, they do have it, but they have it notched down.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, because UGI will require certain things for them.
Well, they have an easement and they have requirements for what you can do within that easement. So, and we're not proposing to make any changes there.
I have a question, Mr. Chair, for Public Works for the next time. Because it's only a proposed parking lot, does the fact that it is all that gravel, that fill, does that pose any concern or challenge or anything like that? So we'll have to get an answer. Or maybe it makes it easier. I don't know.
Yeah, it kind of depends if it's compacted or not, I guess. So, Craig, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I know. I mean, I know you're talking or considering tabling the plan, but I'm also aware that the Reading Parking Authority is extremely anxious to begin the process of getting bids for construction and that sort of thing, which we can't do until we have some sort of approval. Now, under the MPC, a preliminary plan approval would allow us to start seeking bids for construction and that sort of thing. And I was wondering if, in lieu of tabling the plan, the Planning Commission would consider giving us a preliminary plan approval contingent upon Jerome's letter. And next, the next submission then would be a final plan.
My concern is there's no stormwater plan.
Yeah, there's no stormwater plan. We always require that in the preliminary plan. Yeah, we always require at least all applications to be completed, submitted. And there's no stormwater application submitted to Public Works yet.
So Craig, maybe we could do it this way. You just put a letter together stating you want your client wishes to go with a preliminary plan application. You submit the stormwater management report for next month, and then we can do the preliminary approval next month. And then by then, if you need to go through the zoning hearing board, you will have that scheduled, and then final plan probably could be approved in November. October, you would get preliminary plan approval, bids can go out. So that would just be just a simple request and submit that with your stormwater management plan.
Well, I'm gonna have to defer any decisions like that to my client, which fortunately Nathan is here. Would you like to weigh in on this discussion, Nathan?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure how productive my comments would be other than, you know, clearly we're dealing with a parking crisis in the city, and that's very clear if you paid attention to the city council meeting last night and the past couple weeks. So, I mean, we're just trying to get this stuff through in a reasonable amount of time and, you know, produce a good product as well. So I think, you know, your one comment about across the street, you know, and comparing sites, this is a publicly available property versus, you know, a private property. So, you know, that's probably my only comment at this point.
But the saldo doesn't change if it's a public property or a private property. Requirements are still the same.
Sure. I get that.
Oh, but by the way, the that parking lot that's coming together, is that it's park looks like, right? Well, across the street from Burke's, where they're redoing the street today, this week. That's coming together very nicely. So I wanted to just mention that's beginning to look very good over there.
Thanks. We're trying.
Okay.
Yeah. How does the parcel drain currently? Does it just go into the fill, the rainwater?
It drains to McKnight Street. The whole property generally slopes very gently toward McKnight Street, except for the southern end, which kind of goes to the brick alley on the other end.
But how does it drain onto the street? Over the sidewalk or
over the sidewalk? Yeah, there are no stormwater facilities now.
We're
proposing to improve that by
right.
You know, putting
so
in
it's draining another. Okay.
Yeah, we're going to put in a little seepage beds in front of all the parking spaces at front on McKnight. And
I know our public works department will scrutinize all that and report to us what it recommend, but it, you know, just helps to understand.
Uh-huh.
We certainly we we are well aware of the urgent need for the parking in the city, and we're certainly not hostile to this plan. We just have to go through the steps we have to go through so we can approve it and make sure everything is on the up and up. So
one thing I also wanted to bring up, but that the Reading Parking Authority is also proposing a EV charging station, so electric. So there is a charging station, and possibly there'll be more in the future as well. So that's a good thing.
On this side?
Yes.
Oh.
One or two.
Yeah, it's a dual head, so it would have two charging heads on it for two different spaces.
Well, that would require a utility plan then too, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that's going to be a problem for them to connect. As for all uses, I mean, they're handling the utility connection separately.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. All right. Any other questions from the commissioners?
This is Bob Conklin. With the lighting plan, I see that there's a little bit of overbleed. I thought our requirements stated that there would be none, but it seems like there's a little bit going on to neighboring properties. So there might be some shielding or something that's necessary for that, or am I remembering our requirements wrong?
Your requirements are correct. Did you catch that, Greg?
I did. We'll look at that. Okay. You know, one of the issues we have, of course, is, you know, that this is a 24-hour accessible parking lot, and you know, we need to make sure that it's safe for you know, for the people that are using it. So you know, that lighting is important. I know one of the things that in Jerome's letter was that they wanted a reduction by 50% for overnight hours. And I mean, it's a 24-hour facility, so I'm not sure how we can do that and still provide the safety measures that we need to provide for the people that use the lot.
Well, you could ask for a zoning variance for that then, so. All right. Did you hear that, Craig?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. Okay. I'm not sure how good the microphones are in here. So I like to check, just to make sure.
Yeah. I mean, that'll be a discussion I have to have with my client as to what we're going to do about that. I mean, obviously, we're not anxious to go to a zoning hearing because of the time delay. So, you know, we'll have to weigh the pros and cons and decide that, how we're going to proceed with that.
I have a question on that for the planning consultant. I know it's a zoning provision, or maybe the zoning administrator could speak to it. And I looked at it, I tried to find it in the zoning ordinance previously. This is, of course, for the Dark Skies initiative. And it requires the dimming certain hours. But could that effect not be achieved by the shielding of the light, which I think is really one of the main concepts? And therefore, there would still be adequate lighting. It just wouldn't be going up into the sky.
Well, I asked you to look at section 912.B.
Yeah, I don't have it in front of me. I wanted to look. I tried to find where the new ordinance was, and I didn't. But I saw your references in the plans, and I made a mental note to look it up. But if you have it in front of you, if you would please.
Yeah, I was actually incorrect about the hours. It's 10 p.m. to 7 a.m., not 10 p.m. to 6 p.m. So it's nine. It's a little bit longer.
And how does it read?
It's lengthy.
Yeah, you said 912B. Yeah, and the zoning ordinance. Okay. I'll send it over to Will.
Oh, I can find it. I just, if you had it handy.
Okay.
Yeah, and if I may comment about the lighting.
Go ahead.
You know, something to remember in terms of the lighting, you're talking about the rears of all the neighboring three sides of their, all the rears of a building, right? Of a residential building. And if you've ever been out in that area on midnight shift, it is incredibly dark and it is just full of people getting into trouble. And, you know, from a lighting perspective, we kind of would welcome the light. And I think if you talk to neighboring residents there, I'm sure they would welcome the light just because it deters crime. And so we would certainly want to keep as much light there as we could just to keep people safe.
Yeah, I agree with Nathan. That's a rough part of the city.
It is
dark. So yeah, maybe
I was in a foot pursuit with somebody with a gun right through that alley, right across. So yeah, I'm very familiar with it.
Yeah, so the more lighting, the better. And the neighbors would appreciate that also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is Bob Conklin again. Just talk with your lighting supplier and or your lighting specialist. There's ways to properly light an area, either by redistributing the poles and the heads, and or shielding. I'm not suggesting turning the lights down or making it less safe. I'm suggesting that there are ways to get what's needed without putting light pollution on the neighbors. The talk about it's the rear of the house, that's usually where your bedroom is situated.
Mm-hmm.
We want to provide the neighbors with parking areas, but we also want to be a good neighbor to them and not blind them out in the middle of the night.
Yeah, I mean, most of them in the rear there, they're all 6 foot high privacy fences. That's what we're up against. But we can definitely look at the lights.
I have some ideas that we might want to talk about tomorrow, Nathan. I'll run some things by you, okay?
Sure.
All right. Any other comments on this plan? Okay. With that, I'll ask for a motion to table this plan. 641 McKnight Street, parking lot land development plan. Peter? Okay. Second?
Second.
Okay. Thank you, Will. Question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Okay, very good. We will see you next month, and hopefully move this a little bit farther forward.
Thank you, everyone, for your time and your consideration. We appreciate your efforts.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. And next, we have Charlie Carroll. Next, we have Iron Gate Preliminary Land. Is this coming? Final item. Sorry about that. Final land development plan for 228 Moss Street. And I'll turn it over to Jerome for the update.
Okay, this is the. Yeah, this is the one that was added.
The ones
that we put back. Yeah, and they did the adjustment on the.
Just wanted to confirm. Thank you.
We did that on top.
Okay, thank you.
This is the Iron Gate land development plan, which was added to the agenda. At the top of the meeting, we made a motion to make that adjustment. This is a final land development plan, which was submitted by the applicant. It was to address the remaining issues that we had with the preliminary plan application. Although the comments look lengthy, they are comments that we need to have a resolution to as part of this process, which mostly go to the municipal improvements agreement and the stormwater management agreement. So the comments are, the project is essentially the same. It is the proposed use is a 19,305 square foot building, which is going to be a self-storage facility accommodating 228 self-storage units within the facility itself. The plan was submitted again as a final plan application. It was reviewed by the city arborist. The remaining comments that were issued with regarding site accessibility were comments that we all agreed upon at the last meeting, but it would need some form of a resolution to address either by the applicant showing us the draft agreement that he's going to have with his landowners, and then also approval from the Public Works Department with regards to the placement of signs for limiting the types of trucks that can come into the site and down all, and also through Moss Street. The stormwater management comments are just a few that are left with regards to this property. The most critical one is going to be a stormwater management agreement, which is necessary for plan approval. The other comments can be addressed by the applicant on the plan. Curbs and sidewalks were agreed to be modified if necessary. That will also need to be completed by Public Works as part of the plan. With regards to municipal improvements, we did receive a cost estimate for the municipal improvements, which was a partial list. There's some additional items that they need to add for curbs, sidewalks, driveway aprons, traffic control signs, landscaping, and some stormwater facilities. There will be the additions for a 10% contingency and a 10% inspection fee. All in all, the plan looks like it's ready for municipal approval, and we are recommending final plan approval subject to these comments, which were issued on September 26th.
Yeah. Okay. Any comments from the commissioners?
And also, is also a part of payment of any outstanding fees?
Oh, yes.
They did provide a scan copy of the check just to show that if the check was printed and they put it in the mail. And then they did submit to us the final application form as well.
Community Development Office has recommended that we include that within the any form of approval that the fees for a final plan application be submitted by
the
30th. By the 30th. Thanks. September.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, very good. Very good. Hearing no comments, do I hear a motion to grant conditional final plan approval to the Iron Gate Land Development Plan at 228 Moss Street? Subject to the applicant resolving all issues referenced within the review letter by Hawk Valley Associates dated September 26th, 2022, and that all attendant fees and outstanding fees are paid in full by September 30th.
Mr. Chairman, also ask authorization be added for you to execute the agreements if received prior to the next meeting.
And with the addition that any agreements that need to be executed, I will be able to execute those before the next meeting.
I'll offer that motion, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you, Will.
Okay. Second.
Second by Nelson. Okay, question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Very good. We can move this one step forward. Okay, next. Just a mention that there is a supplemental report attached to the agenda for everyone to look at.
And now since Brandy's been on board, I'm gonna be focusing on cleaning these projects up. I've already issued you 9 updates on where the plants are situated with letters just outlining what the outstanding issues are, so we don't run into problems with the plans not being recorded in a timely fashion, and then also the improvements are not completed in a timely fashion. So we've started that process.
Okay.
Great.
Very good.
And now we will move on to plans requesting reaffirmation of approval. And I'll turn this over to Jerome to go over each one of these. Okay. The first one is Fulbright College, the Rockland Warehouse Land Development Plan. It's been some time since this project has been approved. It was last year, I believe. And Aristides is here. So this plan is just brought back for reaffirmation. He submitted the correct forms.
Okay.
And everything is all in place.
Very good.
Yeah, I was reminded that I must have been in a COVID fog. I thought it was earlier this year, but we did submit the signed plans and just need plan reaffirmation so we can get those recorded.
Great. All right. Do I hear a motion to reaffirm the Rockland, Albright College Rockland Warehouse Land Development Plan? This is the warehouse that's on the corner of 12th and Rockland.
Peter?
Okay, Peter? Second.
Second.
Okay, thank you, Will. Okay, question on the motion.
11th Rockland.
Oh, yeah, it is 11th.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very good. Question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Very good. We can get this one squared away too. Rusty's. There are some provisions for some landscaping, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
That's correct. Yes.
Okay. Great. Just wanted to make sure I was remembering it right.
Well, my memory seems to be going since COVID hit. Who knows? But yeah. I appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll see
you. Have a great evening.
You too, guys and gals.
Next we have Dream Ventures. This is 100 South 4th Street Land Development Plan. This is the student housing for Alvernia at the old Turner Textiles building. This plan was approved by you on March 22nd, 2022, subject to conditions which we have outlined. The applicant has submitted a reaffirmation request. And we would need to take action on that. And it's my understanding that the plan is ready for, they have it ready for municipal endorsement. So
they submitted the final plans with signatures today. So once we get that reaffirmation, everything else is handled then.
Okay, great. Hey, can I ask a question? Yeah.
Is there parking associated with that plan?
Good question, Nathan. They, as part of their zoning hearing board application, they were allowed to seek approval to obtain parking from a nearby parking garage, which I think is one of your garages.
Yeah.
So they had the ability to do that. That was a condition of approval. And also they were informed, the zoning hearing board, as part of their testimony, that these students would not be have cars.
Oh, so they're going to prevent students from having cars?
Allegedly. Yeah, allegedly.
Yeah.
But it, right. if they
that's legal. I mean, clearly our board has been very clear about this, right? There's a proper policy and procedure for them to follow when they're developing. And that requires a signed lease with us to get our permission to do that. They do not have a signed lease with us. So we would definitely be opposed to any type of parking relief unless they get a signed lease with us for an adequate amount of parking.
I provided the staff report for that application. If memory serves right, we do have the recording on the website, so you can go back and double check my statements. But if memory serves, they did get relief from that parking requirement, in that they were going to place the burden on the tenants of that building to get a parking agreement or lease. That it wouldn't be with them. Their claim was that they could not reach an agreement with the Rent Parking Authority at that time. But the decision letter is available if anyone needs it. And also the recording of that zoning hearing board hearing is on our website.
Nathan, I think I recall that we also had them put notes on the plan just to, in order to, or just connect point A to point B. On what that requirement would be, we had informed them that they would need a lease from the Reading Parking Authority.
Yeah, I mean, this is how developers are right now trying to get around the parking requirement, right? They are applying for an exception. This developer has done this on a different area in the city, and it was just denied because they always want a 100% parking relief, which is absolutely insane. You have an overtaxed, if you read the parking study that the city spent $130,000 on, you have an overabundance of parking requirement in the commercial core. Why? Because you have all of these buildings being converted into residential buildings. You know, do you think it's adequate and accurate to assume that in a building that size, there's not going to be a single car parked? No, I mean, that's kind of crazy to assume that. Or to even say to your tenant, hey, it's completely on you. I mean, I would love to get around, as somebody who owns commercial and residential properties, I would love to get around the parking requirement on everything I do. But I don't know how we can sustain this. I mean, our board has been very clear, we can't. So is the parking study. So, you know, we strongly object to that. Have we had discussions with them? Absolutely. Have they signed a lease? No. Can they? Yes. They just don't want to because they don't think they need to. And they, you know, this type of action just allows and perpetuates the parking crisis in the city. So from the parking authority's perspective, we absolutely strongly object to that.
We appreciate your comments, and I think they're very welcome. Unfortunately,
The relief
has already been granted by the zoning hearing board. Hopefully you're getting notifications of these hearings and have the ability to attend or at least submit some type of comment.
No, clearly we're not getting that. And clearly we're not being asked for comment.
To avoid any potential conflict, the city should not be asking you for conflict, but you could be added to the list to get a copy of the zoning hearing board. Hearings that are coming up are actually publicized on the city's website and in the paper. Unfortunately, that relief was granted by another board, so this board does not have any control over that. And they've already approved this plan. It's just reaffirmation to allow it to be recorded with Berks County. But I appreciate your comments, and hopefully you're being directed or will be directed and become learn about the timing of the zoning hearings, bring your concerns to them when these applications come before them.
And just so you know, Nathan, this developer has two more projects in the pipeline. So
I mean, clearly, I strongly opposed one the other week, and clearly it was denied because, I mean, that plan was even more insane. Taking the largest building in the city and wanting a 100% zoning relief or a parking relief, like that's just, it's irresponsible. I can't even believe it's actually discussed and considered from a board.
And I would add, Mr. Chairman, that the leases that are required are for, you know, the minimal requirement. It's only for 1 year, because I've made the point that if after the 1 year they are not renewed or they never were executed or whatever, that would certainly be evidence then that the zoning ordinance is not being followed, and there could be action accordingly then.
One final point. We did have our meeting in January, as well as the special meeting we had in February, which was geared to this project. We did bring up a lot of these questions and comments and or issues with regards to the parking, as well as other issues that was where the zoning relief was granted. So I think the Planning Commission has made the same comments you did back in January and February when we considered this plan.
Again, part of my ignorance on this whole process, right? But just so I understand, so the Planning Commission has nothing to do with parking, is that correct?
We do with the design of the parking, and we do review the requirements that are specified within the zoning ordinance. And as it's applied to a site plan, that is our job, where we make sure that the design criteria that's specified within the zoning ordinance or subdivision land development ordinance is carried out.
But as far as the numbers and the calculations, that goes before the zoning, that's under the zoning ordinance.
Okay.
They're the ones that grant relief.
Yes.
Okay.
Did you
want
to say something, Tom?
Yeah, I mean, Nathan, I'm totally with you, because that the project you're referring to, the large one, I don't know if we're allowed to say it or not, but whatever, but that was so over the, you know, that would have created such a large problem in other areas, even though from an economic point of view, it would be better than having an empty building. So I can make sure that anything with parking, any kind of zoning hearing board application would be, I could email you, you know, an agenda for anything that has parking in the future. But I wasn't here back in January or February, so I didn't have the ability to oppose and guide the zoning hearing board on that matter, but I'm totally with you. You know, we expect the parking authority to, you know, some of my evaluations, you know, with like 100% impervious, you know, you have to go to the zoning hearing board for relief, and there's a protocol to follow. Well, that's true of developers too. They just can't waive parking just because it's convenient for them. So I'm totally with you. And I'll make sure that you are aware of anything that involves parking in the future.
And I really appreciate that. And, you know, to the Planning Commission, if you guys ever have questions or want comments from us, just please, I'm sure you have my email, reach out to me or call me. I'm more than willing to be available for, you know, comments and review. And clearly, I think the Berkshire building, which is coming up too on this meeting, is also I think there was parking relief granted for that one as well.
They're foreign exchange students and they don't have cars.
Right. Yeah. Apparently these people have never gone to college.
Yeah.
No, so that was their, that's what they testified before in the zoning hearing.
Yeah. Oh, I remember them at the last meeting, and, you know, they testified and they lied, and I called them out on multiple of their lies. And it's just, it's disheartening that people believe it. So
Nathan, I'm to understand that there is a final version of the parking study?
Yes. Yeah, it was presented to City Council.
Okay. Because the last thing I received was a draft, and that was 2 weeks ago. So I'll get in touch with you for a final version, because obviously the final version isn't here in City Hall somewhere.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I can't tell who was speaking.
Oh, this is Wayne, the chairman.
Okay, hi, sorry, it doesn't come up, it just says zoning office, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Jamal presented the final version of the plan to City Council, probably a month or two ago, I believe it was. I wasn't invited to that presentation, but that's what I was told happened, that there was a final presentation to City Council in regards to that.
Okay, very good. Okay, thank you.
So don't reach out to me for the final version. He had it.
Okay, thanks a lot, Nathan.
Yep.
Yes, Peter.
Curiosity. If zoning relief is granted on the basis of college students and that argument debate accepted, what sort of enforcement is there in terms of who actually occupies the building, whether they are actually college students?
Well, that's a good one for Tom to enforce. If Tom notices a bunch of students driving cars and say parking out in front of the building, then I think the testimony that they have presented is fraudulent, and therefore they could probably take it back to the zoning hearing board.
And the zoning hearing, I believe your zoning decision today, it shall be consistent with the decision and or testimony. And I just saw a line on the recent zoning hearing board that we were given for a plan, another plan for tonight, that said failure to comply with the decision is automatic revocation of the relief.
Yeah, so get the parking police out.
Yeah, it's hard to prove, but if we could prove it, then that would render the decision null and void. But
yeah, and back.
Oh, go ahead, Nick.
I'm sorry, and back to one of your former comments about requiring just a 1-year lease. We've changed, given recommendation from our council, that when we sign a lease with a developer, like we're working with one on Court Street right now, and we require the lease to be in perpetuity until the use case changes. And without that, we kind of learned the hard way with a current developer on two other big sites, where we signed a conditional letter and they were able to get relief and then never ever have the ability to enforce it. So now it's a solid lease. The only way we work with them is if they do a lease and it's in perpetuity, if that makes sense.
Yeah, Nathan, actually the zoning hearing board decision should be in perpetuity because the parking needs to be maintained. It's we don't say in perpetuity in the ordinance, but it does say that conditions need to be maintained. So maintained means, in a sense, it's another definition of perpetuity. So if there's a lease that has expired, you have a developer that's saying that they're no longer tied to that, send me that information. We can look into that and follow up on it and see how the language is written.
Oh man, in the commercial core, it's probably 80% of the 80% of the buildings.
Yeah.
And that's what I was gonna address is, a working relationship that we're giving you information about applications, but just duly publicized. But if you're having leases that are canceled, and particularly in the commercial core, that you think maybe some of the zoning relief may have been relieved based on, please let us know. And that would give us an opportunity to do some enforcement if needed.
Okay. Thank you.
I have sort of a hypothetical question. But let's say there are college students in there, and some number of them do have vehicles, and some number do not. Would a lease involve a variable number of spaces depending on what the actual demand is, or would they have to lease then for the entire potential population?
They should, depending what type of relief they may have been granted from the zoning hearing board, they should have leases for whatever number the zoning hearing board required them to have parking.
So they determine. But I mean, I'm just saying, let's say, they accept that college students might have cars. Do they then have to lease for all potential students, even though not all will have cars?
There's a minimum parking requirements, and then which is 1.5 spaces per unit. And so if they would get a variance for, say the minimum number is 30, and they get a variance for 20, they need to at least provide 20 spaces for their project. Now, whether or not they use all of those or whether or not no more than 20 cars will be used, that's
the decision letter will say they need to provide at least 20 spaces for their tenants, whether or not, you know, they're used, whether, and then if the their tenants exceed that number, there, that's where the variance comes in.
So there's no actual specific consideration to college students that they may not have bars.
It's based on what they believe and what they present to the zoning hearing board and convince the zoning hearing board.
I mean, this is a bit of a challenge for developers. They could be targeting students. The students might have bars or might not. They're required to.
Part of the testimony for 100 South 4th Street was that they would be open to the public. They wouldn't be just for students. It is part of their testimony that they would allow other that would be open.
Mm-hmm. Obviously, let me say, you know, this is going to become as Alberni grows, downtown is going to become a bigger and bigger issue. Housing. And, they've already got a second building now. They're targeting for the next phase, and they are. It is true they are bringing in international students, and it is true that those international students likely will not have bars, or some of them are coming from countries where when we can't drive or you know, don't drive.
Yeah, I mean that was their testimony.
Right. Well, it is true.
Yeah.
Not necessarily true for this building, but you know we need to reach some accommodation for this.
Yeah. Yeah, and I complained about it also about College Town, and they said, oh, well, the students park over at the main campus and they bring the bus into town. And I said, yeah, I've heard that before because I never did that at Albright when I went to Albright. So,
yep.
this is going to be something that you know, we can discuss further as we're working on some of these new zoning ordinances.
I think what we could do also is if an application is brought in and that is brought forward that Albright is going to have the shuttle service available, I think somewhere along the line we need to see the shuttle service route and schedule.
Yeah.
So the shuttle is
operating. Yeah. Yeah, there's usually two buses parked in front of College Town at any time.
But even that, so we're on a little bit of a tangent here, but it's a good discussion. But the thing is, if the zoning hearing board approves residential units and they happen to be for college students and there's a route, you know, for a shuttle bus, that really doesn't, unless that's going to be a condition, whatever. But once a use is established, it's there forever. And one of the things that I would try and, you know, advise the zoning hearing board is, to not just think about this current application, whatever that application is, but what it's going to look like in 10 years or 20 years, because until it's abandoned, it remains. So, you know, to have an argument that it's for college students, these kids don't have cars, whatever, that's kind of a moot point because 5 years from now, 10 years from now, the situation would be totally different. And if they have a special dispensation on parking, with an argument that's no longer valid, then it just exacerbates the problem even more. So the zoning hearing board, I'm trying to educate them a little bit as far as thinking long term and not just what's right in front of them. But,
okay. All right.
Very good. This was a great discussion. Did we hold the vote on them?
No.
Oh. Did I call for? No, I didn't even call for the motion. Okay, so I'll call for the motion to reaffirm the land development plan for 100 South 4th Street. And I'll make that motion since I haven't done any tonight. Do I hear a second?
I just second it too.
Second. Second for Peter. Okay, question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Very good. Next, we have 600 South 9th Street Auto Repair.
land development.
Okay, this project was approved by the Planning Commission on May 24th, 2022. We also issued a follow-up review to provide them guidance on June 17th, 2022, as well as September 22nd, 2022. So reaffirmation is required, and also some site improvements are required, in which we have provided them a comprehensive note to be applied to this plan so they understand what's necessary.
Agreement or no agreement?
It does not require agreement unless it's unless Tim determines otherwise.
Okay. All right. Do I hear a motion to reaffirm the land development plan for 600 South 9th Street?
So move.
Okay, thank you, Nelson. Second?
Bob Conklin.
Okay, Bob. Question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? All right. And the last one on our list here is the Alvernia College Berkshire Building Land Development Plan.
This is a plan that was approved by the Planning Commission on April 26, 2022. Subject to the conditions of approval on April 15th, 2022. And here's one that I've never saw before, but this plan was recorded without your signatures.
I did have a conversation with David Pierce, who, as you know, is now the and assistant county solicitor. He investigated this. You were completely correct, not that I ever doubted that, but it was somehow recorded without signatures. The developer was made aware of it and is now correcting it.
Okay, great. No, I'm glad that David agrees with us. Like I said, I just stumbled upon it while doing some research, and wow. So at least they're aware of it. Okay. All right. So do I hear a motion to reaffirm the Alvernia College Berkshire Building Land Development Plan? Peter, do I hear a second? Yeah, I'll second. question on the motion? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Okay. There we go. We can get these things cleared up. Active plans requiring a time extension.
There are none. But this is something that Brandy's going to be tracking. 90-day time clock starts when the application is filed at the next. So say for example, when plans are submitted, it's really strange the way it's worded, but it starts at the first Planning Commission meeting after it's submitted.
Provided that meeting within 30 days.
Yeah. So we'll go over that in detail, but there are no active plans that are require time extension.
Great. Okay. Announcements and other Planning Commission business. We were supposed to have a workshop meeting on September 20th, but we ran into a problem, so we canceled the meeting. And hopefully we will be able to resolve that problem by our next workshop meeting, which is October something. 18. So hopefully we'll bring that forward and again get those zoning ordinances discussed and work on that stuff. Zoning ordinance and SADO amendments we'll be discussing those at the workshop.
Staff is prioritizing those right now, and we'll be providing you a list of this is what the phase one, phase two, and phase three will be.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Okay.
Chairman, so that meeting was canceled. If there are scheduling conflicts, as we're ending the year and getting ready to think about meetings for next year and advertisements,
you know, if we need to look at new dates, that's a discussion we can have.
Okay. Yeah, because I think we would like to, now that we have a planner on board, I think we would like to continue the workshop meetings and actually do some of the things that we've been supposed to be doing for years, but the administration puts the brakes on a lot of times. So we will, but we will work that out.
Okay, we can talk about dates at the October workshop meeting.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I think that'll be great.
Another consideration too is continuing to offer Zoom once the city's intentions. So we can have that discussion as well.
Yeah, I was actually having a discussion about this with my wife and saying that sometimes it's good to continue the Zoom because of meeting conflicts that some of the especially the engineers and people like that can just go from one Zoom meeting to another. They don't have to drive all over Berks County to get where they need to go. Next on, we have the approval of the Planning Commission meeting minutes. I only found one minor typo. Did you find anything, Will?
They were almost perfect. So I did get to review the fact, yeah. So I would move the approval of the minutes.
Okay, very good. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second from Nelson. Question on the motion?
Of course, I mean,
because I wasn't there.
Okay.
And of course, I mean, Mr. Chairman, with, you know, including your edit.
Oh, yeah. See here, question on the motion. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 And opposed? Okay. And one abstention from Bob. So
I'm officially retired from that, too.
Yeah, good for you, right? I wrote the minutes for the music committee for the Reading Symphony Orchestra for 10 years. After 10 years, I was like,
I told Brandy, I said, it's challenging. And you almost need perfect silence. And fortunately, the recording helps out everything.
Yeah. All right. Next, we will have a workshop meeting on Tuesday, October 18th, here in the third floor conference room. And our next regularly scheduled meeting is Tuesday, October 25th, here in the third floor conference room. Sir, anything for the good of the order? Okay, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
Bob Conklin.
Okay. Bob, second?
Second.
Okay, Nelson? Question on the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Very good. Thank you very much, everyone. A little longer than I was expecting, but it was nice that that Nathan was here to talk about the parking authority. So thanks to everyone again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, everybody.
Recording stopped.